Okay, I'm gonna do a thing on Passover, but a sermon thing. Listen to me. The reason that bitter herbs were used in the Passover Seder, beside the fact, I could be real snarky and tell you, because God said to. It's right there in the Scripture. Look it up. Which I could do, and it's there, and it's in the Scripture. But the good and real answer is, God told them to use bitter herbs. Now remember, what's the purpose of the Passover Seder, the feast, the order of doing things? It's so that the people remember the great work that God did. So the bitter herb is to remind them of the bitterness of their slavery. That get that for you? Knock that one out of the park. Anybody, anything else? Good morning, church. I found a little something on the internet. I'm in the process of, I'm not happy with my email provider. They keep changing things, and I'm upset with it, so I'm looking at moving. And I was going through things, and I found something on one of my emails. And I thought I would share it. It's something like we might post up here in a little bit. An electrical storm caused a blackout in our neighborhood. When the lights went out, I felt my way through the darkness to a storage closet where we kept candles for nights like this. I took my match and lit four of them. I was turning to leave with a large candle in my hand when I heard a voice say, "Now hold it right there." Who said that? Who are you? What are you? I'm a candle. I lifted up the candle to take a closer look. You won't believe what I saw. There was a tiny face in the wax, a moving, functioning, flesh-like face full of expression and life. "Don't take me out of here." "What?" I said, "Don't take me out of this room." "What do you mean? I have to take you out. You're a candle. Your job's to give light. It's dark out there." "But you can't take me out. I'm not ready," the candle explained with pleading eyes. "I need some more preparation." I couldn't believe my ears. "More preparation?" "Yeah, I've decided I need to research this job of light-giving so I won't go out and make a bunch of mistakes. You'd be surprised how distorted the glow of an untrained candle can be." "All right, then," I said. "You're not the only candle on the shelf. I'll blow you out and take the others." But just as I got my cheeks full of air, I heard other voices. "We aren't going either." I turned around and looked at the other three candles. "Your candles and your job is to light dark places." "Well, that may be what you think," said the candle on the far left. "You may think we have to go, but I'm busy. I'm meditating on the importance of light. It's very enlightening." "And you other two, are you going to stay in here as well?" A short, fat purple candle with plump cheeks that reminded me of Santa Claus spoke up. "I'm waiting to get my life together. I'm not stable enough." The last candle had a female voice, very pleasant to the ear. "I'd like to help," she explained, "but lighting the darkness is not my gift. I'm a singer. I sing to the other candles to encourage them to burn more brightly." She began a rendition of "This Little Light of Mine." The other three joined in, filling the storage room with singing. I took a step back and considered the absurdity of it all. Four perfectly healthy candles singing to each other about the light, but refusing to come out of the closet. That's from Max Lucado. Some of you might have recognized that. Well, it was kind of stout if you think about it. As Jesus said, we are the light of the world. He not just said that he was the light of the world, but he turned around and said, we were the light of the world. Yet how many times do we have excuses for not stepping up and doing what we're supposed to do? We're supposed to share the word. I know there's people who go to church that you think of them as good Christians, but when they get out in a crowd, they just kind of disappear. They camouflage themselves. "You can't see me now." That's for all you wrestling fans. When a person believes in something in their heart, they're going to talk about it and they're going to act on it. Sounds like you're getting pretty down on some people. No, I'm getting real. Folks, time is getting short. I'm going to take scripture from 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter, and I'm going to give you a chance to get there because I'm going to remind you. You know, it's not just what we do, it's what we say. Sherry's mom called us this morning, and I wasn't quick enough. I wasn't quick enough. Sherry said, yes, we'll be safe. Okay. Yes, we'll be fine going to church. Bye. And I stopped and I said, why didn't you ask her what church you were going to? She was going to. She said, well, Mom just wanted to know if we were going to church. I said, well, why didn't you ask her if she was? I said, she was all concerned about us traveling and going to and from church. I said, but she wasn't going to church, was she? And you don't have to answer that. I already know the answer. I said, why didn't you ask her? And see, you usually Sherry and her mom talk on a little bit, so I get a chance to say something like that. I didn't get the chance this morning. I'm going to get the chance. Oh, yes, I'm going to get the chance. And it's not just to gouge my mother-in-law. She's too easy. There's no challenge. And being a good Christian, I shouldn't be doing that anyhow. But what I should be doing is living my life. Now, you think about that. I got people not going to church calling to see, are you going to church? It's supposed to get some bad weather today. Mm-hmm. Now, there's times I say, you didn't go to church that? No. I said, we called around and we decided the roads were too hazardous and we wanted to make sure everyone was safe and we called it off. Well, that's understandable. Well, what about today? I said, I'm going today. So I don't care if we got two or three people. I can remember walking through this door and there's four people sitting here. Praise the Lord. We got more than that now. And you know, I can go on and preach about how being holy is our reasonable service, how we need to walk into grace. I can go on about and do what I can to model through my actions and through my sermons and try to show you and teach you how, as a Christian, you should walk and talk your life. But I'm going to boil it down real tight here. 1 Timothy 6th chapter, starting with the 11th verse. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Jesus Christ, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Keep what commandment? Fight the good fight of faith and provide a good profession before many witnesses. Yes, there may be times when the Lord tells me to talk specifically to someone that I don't know, and I'm going to do that. But as I walk down the street, people should know by the way I walk, by the way I talk, by the way I dress. And I'm not putting a dress code out there on you. I'm saying modest dressed. I'm not saying, you know, I'm being reasonable here. People should look at me and say, there's something about him. There's a spring in his step. He's not just happy, there's a joy there. What's going on? How can I get me some of that? People, do you realize how bad people are panicking out there? How bad is it about to get? I saw how bad it's about to get. I've been reading some here, and people are just going berserk. Do you want the international or the national news? In the international news, they're throwing chemicals around in Syria. In Cyprus, to be exact, the banks are saying the government's saying we are so bad off to get this money to come in to help us pay our debts, we have to take so much percent out of your savings accounts. Their savings accounts. Okay, so.
Yeah, you're right.
So this sort of thing. Oh, that's horrible. What? I have joy in my salvation. I'm just passing through this life. Mm-hmm. But they're going to be filling the air with drones. Well, send them in here and maybe they'll hear the word of God. I don't care. What are they going to do? Shoot me with a rocket and send me straight to Jesus. Yeah, that like that's going to hurt me. Maybe for a second. You're going to see people panicking here. I'm going to tell you two things that are coming. Two things that are coming. One of the things that's coming is you're going to find people panicked, upset, and with it there's going to be a lot more crime, and there's going to be a lot of people, there's going to be some push for people to get back into church because they're looking for, things will be getting so bad because with the rules that are out there now, for some companies, it's going to be cheaper just to lay off everybody until they get under 50 people so they don't have to. Because if they don't, they end up paying over half of their profits in taxes. For others, we only have part-time people here. We've got under this minimum wage by keeping everybody under 40 hours a week. But to get under this now, we're going to cut everybody to under 30 hours a week. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's going to help. And nobody's hiring. Why would you hire if it's going to cost you that much extra? It's going to get ugly, folks. Mm-hmm. And we cannot feed the world. We cannot heal the world. We can only do what God has us do. And the first and most important thing we can do is to stand as a Christian and say, thus saith the Lord, thou shalt and thou shalt not. Thus saith the Lord, this is about hope and mercy. I can help you or I can't help you. You need to go over here, you need to go over there, or get away from me. Can you make those decisions? You really hate to say that to people, wouldn't you? You just get away from me. Let me tell you. Someone come when things get bad and I have to take care of my family first, someone comes to me for help. Who's Jesus? Who's Jesus? If the first words out of their mouth are not my Lord and Savior, I don't have to help them. Unless God specifically tells me to help them. Now, someone comes to me and they're a Orthodox Jew and they need help, that's a different matter altogether. They're one of God's. I'll take care of them. I'll help them. There's a lot of people out there that think that Christians are pansies, they're weak, and that because of what we believe, they can ask us for anything, and we have to give it to them. Sounds pretty mean, preacher. No, I'm being realistic. Mm-hmm. There are people who, if you let them, will attach themselves to you like a leech and suck every dime of money you've got, every crumb of food you've got, and then be mad that you can't help them anymore. Maybe, as Christians, if we're giving a good profession before many witnesses, maybe we ought to talk to people about Jesus before we give them some food. Maybe we ought to invite them to church. Maybe we ought to say, come on to church with me. I'll take care of you after church. Mm-hmm. See how many people that puckers up? I'm serious. If someone's not wants your help and they're not willing to come to church with you, why do you need to help them? That's mean, preacher. No, I'm telling you what the Scripture says. Mm-hmm. Scripture says, if a man doesn't take care of his family, he's worse than an infidel and is denied the faith already. Yes. Scripture also talks about how in Acts, I'm pretty sure, if not, I'll find it. Paul, this might have been in Galatia. Paul went. He told the church, I'm coming. And what I want you to do is on the first day of the week when you meet, bring forth as God has prospered you so that when I get there we can appoint someone and have them take it to the brethren in Jerusalem who are starving. After you take care of your family, your next responsibility is to the brethren. He asked them to give joyfully out of what God has increased them. And the whole purpose is to go and give relief to Christians. Yeah, it kind of impressed me that there were some Christian groups who, after Katrina, followed that. Mm-hmm. There were some people got mad at him. But you know what they did? They went down there and they rebuilt churches. Mm-hmm. And they got those churches up and running and stocked their food pantries and went on to other churches. They didn't build people's houses. Yeah. They didn't clear roads. Those weren't their jobs. They were there to take care of their brothers and sisters in Christ. Let's get these churches up and running. In a disaster like that, a church is worth more than a fire department. A good profession of faith. Big old Sandy hit New England. Mm-hmm. And there's all these people up there waiting on the government to take care of them. I haven't heard of any churches moving up there to help anybody, but I haven't heard of any churches up there asking for help either. Right. Haven't heard it. You don't hear of people asking for help. You don't hear about it being desperate. But you know what I do hear being desperate? I hear the children in the county schools being desperate. Mm-hmm. When there is such a lack of oversight and discipline that children are allowed to harass each other. They get into fights and kids end up in the hospital. And what about our governments? Everything you see going on out here is all about controlling you, about making you say and think and do what is right. And tell you what, in 1 Thessalonians, in the second chapter, verse 4, it says, "But as we were allowed of God to be put in trust with the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing men, but God, which trieth our hearts." I don't particularly care what any government says, what any administration says. I'm going to tell them what God says, right here in this book. I want to praise the Lord for Jeff Foxworthy and the Bible, that Bible game show he's got.
Yes.
It's good, it's great, but if you aren't careful, it becomes a diversion. Mm-hmm. I mean, they've got people on there, and they're competing for money for charities. That's a great thing. I'm not kicking that. That's a great thing. And they're checking their Bible knowledge, and that's a good thing. And it's uplifting to Christians. But are they getting the message of salvation out? And I'm not kicking them, because what they're doing is probably getting some people who've been sitting at home forever. They just might be stirring them up and getting them to head back to church, or back at least ways back into their Bibles. So I'm not kicking. I think it's doing a good thing. I'm looking forward to watching that continuing Bible series. I've really enjoyed it. Last episode, I didn't nitpick it. I had to keep telling Sherry, "Shut up, you're nitpicking it. Shut up, you're nitpicking it." And last night, someone else had some kind of Bible series on, and after watching about 20 minutes of it, Sherry's sitting there going, I said, "Do you just enjoy watching train wrecks? That's not even close to what the scripture is." She's, "You're right. I don't know. It's just kind of fascinating to see how bad it is." Mm-hmm. And off we went. And hey, we had Jeff Foxworthy on. We had him on DVDs or DVR, so we got to watch him. Mm-hmm. Got a little uplifted there after watching some. Just because someone says they're doing something about the Bible or about Jesus, they don't make it so. I've seen the History Channel do a lot of things about this was Jesus, or, you know, this was the Bible, or all kinds of things. And the more I look at it, the more I'm like, the History Channel hates Christians. Mm-hmm. They're trying to distort it. And I could even say that about this latest show, but this latest show is, while it's got some inaccuracies, it's actually pretty good. Mm-hmm. It's pretty good, and it's pretty close. And I'm not going to quibble about a few inaccuracies if it's getting people to watch and getting them interested.
There was one controversy I saw on it that people decided they had to make something up. They decided that whoever they had made up as Satan in the last episode, which he's in Morocco where they're filming this, mm-hmm. he's a well-known actor in Morocco, and that's the role he usually plays. So he usually does religious films, and he, because of the way his face is built, he usually ends up playing the devil or a demon or something. And they said, and so they decided to make an issue out of it, said that that he looked too much like Obama, so they were saying that Obama was the devil.
Oh, for pity's sake.
And thus it goes. We need to have a good witness. We need to fight the good fight of faith. People are going to keep coming at you and telling you. And if you aren't careful, you're going to be like that piece of sand on the beach. You think you're a rock, you've stood against the wind, and you're still there, and you're just hanging on. And waves keep beating on you, and you don't think about it too much because you're still there. Eventually, all that support you got gets washed away, and next thing you know, you're gone. It's not the big things. You know, it's not the... You have to accept abortion as normal. You have to accept homosexuality as normal. Those are easy. That's not the stuff that's going to get you. It's when your friend, who's a real strong Christian, suddenly starts making excuses for why their son or daughter is having a child out of wedlock. Suddenly there's nothing wrong with it, and you have someone compromising. No, it's not the baby's fault. The baby needs to be well taken care of, absolutely. But both those children, and I don't care what their age is, need to understand that fornication's a sin. They've committed it, and they will never see their child in eternity unless they turn themselves over to Jesus and ask for forgiveness and become a Christian and start living it and walking it and talking it. Mm-hmm. And you tell people that and they'll get mad at you. And you say, here's where I got it. Get mad at the author. You can talk to him by getting on your knees. I'm getting tired of milquetoast Christians. You don't know how much I want a confrontation. I think that's why the Lord won't let me have a confrontation with people, because I would enjoy it too much. I shouldn't enjoy it. But you know, I'd love to talk with people about what they believe and why they believe it. You know, people come at me, and if someone comes at me and this is right, and I say, oh, okay, so let me get this right. I'm trying to understand you. You believe this because you believe this, so you believe this. Right. So since you believe this, then you must believe this, 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 this. Oh, no, 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 no. No, I believe that in that. Well, no, that's against what you said you believed over here. They get mad. I said, well, if you don't have any absolute beliefs, then you've got no belief at all. Nothing you say means anything. But people get mad. What must I do to gain eternal life? Nicodemus, you must be born again. That, in the original, it can also be translated as born from above. What? I've got to go back into my mother's womb? Nicodemus, you're one of the most educated, intelligent men in all of Israel, and you don't understand? something simple. John chapter 3, if you want, I'm going to read what I'm paraphrasing. How are we born again? I'm gonna lay this out real quick. And this is the way conversion works. Okay? I can go and I can find the scripture for it all if anybody really wants me to. But here's the way it works. You will not get saved unless God calls you. Period. You must be called. And God will call each and every person because He is willing that none be lost. He wants everyone to be saved. But you must be called of God. And being called of God may mean that He has your friend bug you. Come on to church. Come on to church. Look, if I go to church with you just once, will you just shut up and quit bugging me about? Yeah. Just come with me once. You've been called to church, and that's why you're there. Doesn't matter how you get there. You get called to church by God. When you get called to church, there's going to be some preacher who's going to preach, or some singer who's going to sing, or someone who's going to get up and testify. And through them, the Holy Spirit will convince you that of who Jesus is. Convince you that there is an eternal judgment, and convince you that, yes, you've sinned and you're going to meet that judgment. Then with a broken heart and a contrite spirit, you come and you talk to Jesus about it. You make Him your Lord and Savior. And He washes you clean in His blood. Then there's this thing called the Holy Spirit. He's God also. He takes up residence. And he's there in varying degrees. I mean, there's always some of Him there. Well, how can you say that, preacher? Well, because the Scripture clearly says multiple times, and this disciple or this apostle was filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, if he was filled, then at some point he wasn't necessarily empty, but he wasn't full. You can be filled multiple times, but that's getting on past it. Anyhow, from God calling you to the Holy Ghost being with you as the Comforter, that's how you get saved. Amen. That's nuts and bolts. How many never heard that before? Be honest. Maybe I preached it. But there's people that won't believe. Oh, it doesn't work that way. Yeah, it does. I can pick you the scripture out. I can take you through the scripture. Mm-hmm. That's how salvation works. And God will use us. Through our walk, through our talk, through our witness to other people. To call people, to convict people. On that last day, I assuredly do not want to stand before my Lord and Savior with Him saying, you know, I told you to talk to Him. That was His one chance, and you didn't. So He's doomed to an eternity away from me because you refused to talk to Him. That sounds pretty harsh. But I'm going to give you the reality of it. How many of y'all have heard of the gospel group Gold City? Okay. Have any of y'all ever got any of their Golden Anniversary albums? They've got a Golden Anniversary album. It's their 20th anniversary. On the second album, which is my fave, their bass singer gives his testimony. about how he started off with, I forget the name of the group. They're still around. He started off singing gospel with them, and he got his draft notice to Vietnam. And he went to Vietnam. And his mama packed his Bible for him, and he never cracked it while he was there. And when he got back, he was having some rough times in his life. And he's raised Baptist, but a little old Pentecostal boy led him to the Lord. And he went back and he got that Bible, and his mom had underlined scripture in it that would encourage him. The Romans wrote all of it. And he never cracked it. And he said, at that point, his heart broke. And he asked the Lord to take him then. He said, because all the times that he was in Vietnam, and he'd look into the eyes of those poor young men that were dying, saying, Doc, am I going to make it? And he said, because of my rebellion, I wasn't able to stoop down and tell them about Jesus. He said, I've been forgiven of that. Now think about that. He's been forgiven of that. How that weighs on that man. You think that he doesn't take a chance to talk to people about Jesus every chance he can? Mm-hmm. Never again. That's the goal. We're here planting and sowing and reaping. We're trying to get people to heaven. Mm-hmm. If I've got to be obnoxious to someone, I'm going to be obnoxious to them. If I can talk to them reasonably, I'm going to talk to them reasonably. And if I can't get through to them, Lord, I've done everything. I don't want to deal with them anymore. Send somebody else. Or just take them. The reprobate. That sounds harsh, but this is what we're talking about today. Fight the good fight. That's all I've got, church. Anybody got anything? Any stump preachers or you got any announcements?
Whatever happened with the sledgehammer incident, how's he doing?